October of 2006, Matthew Swatzel was leaving his 24-hour shift at work. It was early in the morning as he was driving home. He fell asleep at the wheel, and his vehicle crossed the center line, and he hit a car head-on. And in that car was a mother who was 7 months pregnant and a 19-month-old daughter. And in that setting, the mother died, as well as the baby yet to be born. The 19-month-old survived. A father got a call that evening from his pastor, sharing with him the news that he was to go to the hospital immediately, and then he discovered what had happened. How would you respond to that? Of course, we all know how tragic the accident is, but how would you respond days, months, years later in dealing with the individual that had caused the accident? Well, Eric Fitzgerald was confronted with that very issue. Sometimes we don't understand what happens in life and why it happens, and I think one of the most critical issues in our lives, particularly as believers, is dealing with this issue of forgiveness. How do we deal with the hurt that has happened to us? And I think some of us know what we should do, but we really have a hard time doing it. And today, I want to help us understand from God's Word why it's critical that we get this right. Now, last Sunday, I began a series about forgiveness, forgiven to forgive. We lost a Sunday because of a snow day, and so really I'm combining two messages into one. And here's what I'm trying to communicate today. If God has forgiven you, which He has, then I must forgive myself, and I must forgive others. And we really don't have a choice about that, as we'll see from God's Word. Remember, last week we talked about what forgiveness is not. Forgiveness is not excusing sin. Forgiveness is not forgetting sin. God's the only one who does that. Forgiveness is not denying your feelings. It really happened. It's legitimate pain that you have. Forgiveness is not reconciliation. Forgiveness might be a step toward reconciliation, but it doesn't necessarily mean that the two will be reconciled. Healthy boundaries may need to still exist. Forgiveness is not conditional. If you take this step, then I will forgive you. That's not what forgiveness is. So here's the question. How do I know that God has forgiven me, but I can't forgive myself? I still feel guilt. And really, my conscience screams at me because I'm having a hard time forgiving myself. 1 John 1:9 says that if we confess our sin, He's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That God forgives us of all our sins. Those that have happened, He forgives us. So what are you really saying when you say, I can't forgive myself? What are you really saying? I don't think we mean this, but this is what we're actually saying. First of all, you're questioning God's forgiveness. You don't really believe what God has said and what God has done, that He has forgiven you. You're saying that what He is saying is not true. Now, we don't want to believe that, accept that, but that's what we're saying. If God has forgiven you, then you must forgive yourself. Or maybe you are overpaying for sin. This is what you really mean. This is what practically it means. If it's all paid for, why are you going to the bank and trying to pay off a note that's been paid off for 2,000 years? If you say, I can't forgive myself, you're overpaying. You're trying to still pay on a note of debt that's already been forgiven. God has forgiven you totally. Well, I ought to be paying more. The word guilt is a Yiddish word, and it means simply debt. A guilty man feels like he has to pay something. when he's done something wrong, I owe somebody and I need to pay them. Well, Jesus paid your debt, therefore leave it alone. Remember last week, Colossians 2:14, that he took my certificate of debt, the Bible says, nailing it to the cross. So we have this debt that's on us, but that debt has been paid. What you're really saying also is that your morality is higher than God's morality. God says, my process is not good enough for you, that I didn't do enough, and so your standard of morality is higher than mine, because what you're saying is, God didn't do enough, more has to be done in order for my sin to be forgiven. Now, this is really what we're saying. God did not do enough to take care of my sin. Now, what did God do to take care of your sin? He put his son, Jesus Christ, on the cross. So what more does he have to do so that you can forgive yourself? He's done everything that he's needed to do to forgive you. Look, nobody has a greater view of sin than God. No one has a more serious view of sin than God does. We don't have a more serious view of it. God does, and God showed it by the love of the cross. Also, what you're doing is you're giving the devil a foothold in your life. Listen, Jesus is thrilled when you walk away and say, he did enough. That pleases him. To be able to say that God did enough for me when Jesus died on the cross, my sin is forgiven. And he wants his people to be satisfied with what he's done for you. Now, the devil doesn't. And the devil's going to try to convince you that you're not forgiven. Well, a foothold begins. It becomes a stronghold. And then that stronghold leads to a spirit of self-condemnation. Do you find yourself always talking down about yourself, condemning yourself? You're a bad person. You're not worthy. Who would love you? Who would like you because of what you've done? And it just keeps spiraling down. Well, we need to arrest that thought and get back to where it belongs. And that is where, don't let that foothold begin. Accept what Jesus has done for you. Another reason that you may not have forgiven yourself is because you've not properly confessed your sin. The word confess in the language of the New Testament means to say the same thing. The word speak is a compound word. Speak the same. That's what it means. Speak the same thing. Confession means to say the same thing that God says. Whatever God has said, I'm agreeing with him. And we confess that Jesus is our Savior and our Lord, but we don't need to stop our confession there. We need to continue to confess what God has already said. And when God convicts us of sin, that's what we mean by confessing your sin. I'm agreeing with what God has said about my sin. So, really, true confession is agreeing with God about whatever he says. If God says you're lost, then you're lost. If God says you're saved, then you're saved. If God says you're forgiven, then you're forgiven. You're forgiven. If that's what he has said, that's what's happened. It doesn't matter how you feel about it. It's what God has said about it. Now, you may not be able to forgive yourself because you can't forgive yourself before God has forgiven you. In other words, before you've accepted God's forgiveness for your sin. That's why you may be having a hard time forgiving yourself, because you've never received God's forgiveness for your sin. Therefore, you can forgive yourself. Because, see, your sin is not just against another person. Your sin is against God. And that's why that sin has to be dealt with by God. And you need to accept what God has done for that sin. He's forgiven you. So, if God has forgiven you, you must forgive yourself. Now, there's a whole lot more there. That was supposed to be today's sermon. There's a whole lot more there I could say, but I want to move next to, if God has forgiven me, or if God's forgiven you, then you must forgive yourself. Open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 4, and I want to begin reading in verse 22 what Paul writes here. It gives a great context as he talks about forgiving others. Of course, there's much in the Bible about forgiving others, many illustrations of God's people who were put in a position where they had to forgive others. I think none more classic than Joseph forgiving his brothers who betrayed him and sold him into slavery. But God, in his divine providence, was using all of that for his purpose. And it's a great story that you need to read. And so here in Ephesians 4, here's the context. Verse 22, Paul is talking about these who are now believers in Christ. You took off your former way of life, the old man that is corrupted by deceitful desires. You are being renewed in the spirit of your minds. You put on the new man, the one created according to God's likeness in righteousness and purity of truth. Since you put away lying, speak the truth, each one to his neighbor, because we are members of one another. Be angry and do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. And don't give the devil an opportunity. The thief must no longer steal. Instead, he must do honest work with his own hands so that he has something to share with anyone in need. A man this morning, just a few minutes ago, told me that he'd been gone 2 days, drove to his house at the gate, and there was a guy driving his truck across the field trying to steal the truck right there. Met him at the gate. Talk about God in that. Amazing. The thief should no longer steal. He must work with his own hands. No rotten talk should come from your mouth, but only what is good for the building up of someone in need in order to give grace to those who hear. And don't grieve the Holy Spirit who sealed you for the day of redemption. All bitterness, anger, and wrath, insult, and slander must be removed from you along with all wickedness. And be kind and compassionate to one another, here it is, forgiving one another. To what extent? Just as God also forgave you in Christ. Now, there are four questions I want to answer this morning. First of all, what is forgiveness? In verse 32, you see the word forgiving and the word forgave. Well, let's look at a definition of the word forgive. Well, in the English language, again, it's a compound word, for and give. The word for there is the prefix, and according to Webster, it means to give. Something that is put away, something that is put off. Now, the word give here means that I have something that I'm going to transfer to somebody else without it costing them anything. So I have, it's to give a gift, make a gift towards somebody. And so something I have, it's being given away toward somebody else. Now, in the dictionary, the word forgive means to give up resentment. To give up resentment. But the Bible puts a completely different spin on this word, forgive. In the language of the New Testament, the Greek language, this word forgive also is a compound word. And the root word is the word charis, or the word grace. Now the difference is that I'm not just giving up resentment, but I'm giving away grace towards somebody when I forgive them. I am showing them God's grace. I'm giving them a picture of His grace. I'm giving away Jesus Christ. Now, when I say I'm giving away grace, I'm not giving it to them in the sense of salvation. I'm just showing them grace. I'm giving them a picture of God's grace whenever I forgive someone. So there's a vast difference. The world says it's giving up resentment. Okay, that's a good thing. You need to get rid of the resentment. But it's much more than that for the believer, because when they see us forgiving somebody, it is a picture of the grace of God. So what is it? It's reflecting Jesus Christ. That's forgiveness. Now, how do you know that you have forgiven someone? Now, there are those here who would say, I know I should, and I'm trying, but I don't know if I really have. Well, let me help you with that. How do you know that you've really forgiven someone? It's being aware of what someone has done, and you're still willing and able to forgive them. In other words, you say to yourself, I want to forgive them, but I don't think I really could if they actually did what it seems they did. Well, you haven't forgiven them. If I know what they've done, and have forgiven them, then you've forgiven them. But if you're still saying to yourself, boy, if they really did what I thought they did, or if they really meant what they said, that's really bothering me. Well, you haven't forgiven them. So you know you're aware of what they said and did, and potentially the motive for why they did it. You may not be sure about that, but if that's what they meant, you're able to still forgive them. All right, how do you know? You're refusing to punish them. Now, I'm not talking about crimes that are committed against somebody. I'm not talking about protecting society. Those things should happen. But when someone wrongs you, are you going to make them pay in some form or fashion for what they've done? John writes in 1 John 4, there is no fear in love. Instead, perfect love drives out fear because fear involves punishment. So the one who fears has not reached the perfection in love. Your fear is they won't be punished. Where's the justice? Who's going to deal with this? Perfect love drives out fear. What does that mean? I can trust God to take care of it. God's big enough to take care of those who have wronged you. Now, how do you know you've forgiven somebody? By not telling what they did. We often have the need to tell somebody we've been hurt. Now, that's good for counseling reasons. That's who you need to be talking to if you've been hurt. You need to go to the counselor and you need to sit down with them and you need to say, I've been wronged and I'm struggling how to deal with this, or with a pastor or somebody who's going to give you wise counsel, godly advice. If you've truly forgiven someone, you're not going to have a need to gossip about them, to talk about them. We like to tell others to hurt someone's credibility, their reputation, or their integrity. We tell what that person did so that person will think less of them. We want people on our side justifying that what they did was wrong. Really, it's a way of punishing someone. I may not talk to them directly, but I'm talking about them to other people, and I'm punishing them for what they've done. If God does not punish you for your sins, why are you punishing somebody else for their sins? I mean, if we really stop and think about it, has God really punished me for what I deserve? No. So why should I do that to somebody else? Well, here's how you know. If you're still talking about them, you've not forgiven them. If you're still talking about what happened, and what they did, you've not forgiven them. Well, how do you know you're merciful? You're being merciful. Matthew 5:7 on the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Blessed are the merciful, because they will be shown mercy." Because God is merciful, He does not want to punish us. Because He is just, He must punish us because we've sinned against Him. Now, how are those two ideas reconciled? Well, they are at the cross. That's where it happened. I know what I deserve, and I know what I want, and together, God has dealt with that at the cross. So, are you merciful? I know that I've dealt with this if I'm merciful to those who have hurt me. It means that you're gracious. I know that I've forgiven somebody if I'm gracious. As I mentioned, true forgiveness shows grace and mercy. Mercy is not getting what you deserve. That's justice. Grace is getting what you don't deserve. That is God's favor. And what does grace do? Grace cuts against legalism. It's not that eye for eye, tooth for tooth, that I am able to trust God and show grace. Jesus showed grace over and over. We find in the Bible, I shared last week an illustration, the woman caught in adultery, where He showed grace. He shows grace to us. Also, you know that you have forgiven somebody when your heart is right. Forgiveness must take place in the heart or it's meaningless. Matthew, Jesus said, "For the mouth speaks from the overflow of the heart." If you've forgiven somebody in your heart, then you really don't even have to know that your enemy has accepted your forgiveness. They may or may not accept it. And it really doesn't matter, because in my heart, I've made things right with God, and I've made things right with that other person, in that I took the initiative of trying to make things right, whether they accept it or not. My heart is where it should be. But again, remember, it's the inner victory that matters most. That's what Jesus is concerned about, is the inner victory. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they are doing. Now, here's a big one. How do I know that I have forgiven somebody? There's no bitterness. Here in verse 31, all bitterness must be removed. A great verse, Hebrews 12:15. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no root of bitterness springs up, causing trouble, and by it defiling many. You see, the bitterness has to be dealt with in terms of its root. So I've got to go to the source of what happened and who did it, and I need to deal with it. And you'll see it's a deeper root than that we'll get to. And it will spring up. At some point, it will come up. I think I've shared with you before about Sigmund Freud. You know, there's a lot of things I don't agree with what he said, but I think he was right about this. He said that all of us have monsters inside of us, and we put them in the basement, and we do everything we can to keep them in the basement. But in the strangest time, in the strangest place, all of a sudden one of those monsters come out of our mouth, and we call that a Freudian slip. A Freudian slip. And that's what the Bible is teaching us. A root of bitterness springs up. If it's there, it's going to come up. Now, you wait just a few months, the weeds are going to come up because the root is still there. So we have to deal with it in terms of its root. And then that verse says, it defiles many. You see, your bitterness is not just affecting you, it's affecting others around you. And you may think you're hiding it, and it's not there, but that bitterness is going to spring up, and when it does, it's going to hurt a lot of people, if not already. So it needs to be dealt with. Now listen, if you're bitter, you're also allowing somebody else to control you. They're determining what you think and how you act. And I said a long time ago, I'm not going to let somebody else dictate the way I think and the way that I feel who has hurt me, because there is way too much at stake in my life and in your life. There's way too much at stake. If you're in a marriage, there's too much at stake. If you have children, there's too much at stake. If you have a job, there's too much at stake. If you're a Christian, there's too much at stake to let somebody else be controlling you because of your bitterness. And we may not, again, want to see that and accept that, but that's the reality of what's going on. So if I know that I have forgiven somebody, if there's no bitterness there, it's been dealt with. Also, I know that I am I've forgiven somebody if there is peace with God. Now, here's the most important point. All bitterness is ultimately bitterness toward God. All bitterness is ultimately bitterness toward God. Because your anger is not just directed at that person. It's directed to God. Because God allowed this to happen in your life. And so don't kid yourself, don't fool yourself, don't be deceived by the enemy, because this is the tool of the enemy to separate you from God, to divide you from God, to break your fellowship with God, is that your bitterness toward that other person is really bitterness toward God, and it's going to affect you and your relationship with Him in a very negative way. Remember Romans 8:28, all things work together for good to those who love God and are called according to His purpose. His purpose is not for you to be bitter. His purpose is not for somebody else to control your spirit. His purpose is for His Spirit to control your spirit. And you've got victory over that because of what Christ did on the cross for that sin that's been committed against you. Notice also Psalm 119. David says, "It was good for me to be afflicted so that I could learn of your statutes." He learned more about himself and he learned more about God because of the trouble that he had gone through. Now, what happens if you don't forgive? A few things. First of all, the Holy Spirit is grieved. Notice in this chapter, verse 30, "And don't grieve God's Holy Spirit who sealed you for the day of redemption." When the Holy Spirit is grieved in your life, it causes distortion in your mind. You're not able to think clearly about life. When the Holy Spirit is grieved, the Holy Spirit's not operating, giving you the insight that you need. The worker of the Spirit enables you to cope with life and its challenges. Remember what I said at the end of my last series. We're trying to help equip you for life. And so you need to get this tool in your life to equip you that I'm not bitter towards somebody and grieving the Holy Spirit because I need the Spirit to help me cope with life. An unforgiving spirit is going to hinder that work of God in your life. Also, what happens if you don't forgive? You're left to yourself. God steps away and let the natural consequences of your bitterness take place. If you want to try to handle that situation on your own, then he's going to let that happen. He's going to back away and let that happen. And when that happens, Satan has access to you. Verse 27, notice, don't give the devil an opportunity. Paul writes in 2 Corinthians, "Now to whom you forgive anything, I do too. For what have I forgiven, if I have forgiven anything? It is for you in the presence of Christ, so that we not be taken advantage of by Satan, for we are not ignorant of his intentions." He's going to come after us if we remain bitter towards somebody else. Also, you lose your potential of God's anointing in your life. Look, we all need the power of God in our lives. And we don't want bitterness to remove that anointing. We just become an empty shell. Also, we have no authentic fellowship with God if we don't forgive. 1 John 1:6, "If we say we have fellowship with Him," that's God, "and walk in darkness, we are lying and are not practicing the truth." Jesus said again on the Sermon on the Mount, "For if you forgive people their wrongdoing, your heavenly Father will forgive you as well. But if you don't forgive people, your Father will not forgive your wrongdoing." Again, there's too much at stake for that to happen. I want to know that I have all of God's forgiveness for every sin that I've committed. So there are two aspects to forgiveness. One is judicial and one is spiritual. The judicial side is that you've been legally forgiven. You've been declared righteous by the work of Christ. And then there's the spiritual side of it. I need my spiritual life unaffected. I don't want anything hindering my spiritual experience with Christ, and bitterness will do that. So, how do you forgive others? How do you forgive others? Well, first of all, study God's Word about forgiveness and about bitterness. Just look in your concordance in the back of your Bible, or get on the internet and Google some source that will help you, and study God's Word about forgiveness and about bitterness. Then confess that God has forgiven you. Confess that. If you've not done that already, even in today's singing, there have been lines in some of the lyrics and some of the songs that we've sung that talk about God's forgiveness. We've confessed God's forgiveness for our sin. So make that confession. Get along with God and say, "God, I want to say once again how grateful I am that you have forgiven me." And then pray. Pray, ask God to empower you. You need God's help to forgive that person who's wronged you. And pray, begin praying right now for that person by name. You may not want to. You don't feel like it. They've deeply wounded you. But I want to help you. I want to help equip you. If you want to be free from this, start praying for them by name. then help free that person from guilt. Our flesh wants them to feel bad. Look, all of us feel that way. There have been times in my life I want them to feel bad for what they said or did to me. But you can't stay there. That feeling's normal, but you can't stay there. You got to move past that. So you want to free them from the guilt that they've experienced. Now, I didn't finish the story about Matthew Swatzel and Eric Fitzgerald. Because of Eric's attitude was this. He'd been hurt. Lost a wife, 7-month-old pregnant child. And he said that I know I should forgive, and I want to forgive this person for what they've done, Eric. And for 2 years he was not able to talk to Matthew because of what happened, because of legal proceedings, although he did not press charges. He chose not to do that. And so for 2 years they couldn't connect. And then one day he went to the grocery store to pick up something, and there in the parking lot he saw Matthew. And Matthew's the one that caused the accident. Eric sees him, and he said, "I see him," and he stands. It's the 2-year anniversary of the accident, and he's crying. I walked over to him, and he said, "You know, we've not been able to talk, but I want you to know that I have forgiven you for what you've done." And he gave him just a big bear hug. And he said, "You know," he said, "I really believe that God wants me and you to walk together through this." And for the next 10 to 12 years, that's what they've been doing, demonstrating God's grace. Now, somebody would ask him, "How did you do that?" And here's his quote. He quotes verse 32 of this chapter. He said, "I chose to obey God's word, which says, 'Be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you.'" He said this, "Forgiving people forgive people." That's just true. There are no caveats. There are no ifs, ands, and buts. As a Christian, I've received forgiveness. I need to also forgive. You got to begin to live it out. It's a process. There are days where you've got to wake up and just remind yourself, "I'm forgiven and I forgive." Forgiveness isn't a feeling. You don't have to feel like it. It's a process, faithfully living out what God has firmly told us to do in His Word. But there's a moment where you've got to make a decision and you've got to surrender and say, "I'm going to do it God's way." And I want to say today that this is the moment. This is the place where you've got to say, "I'm going to do it God's way." I want you to experience all that God has for you. And if you're bitter, if you've not forgiven the wrong that has happened in your life, you're not going to experience all that God has for your life. He wants you to be free from this. And why not this morning say, "I want to be free"? I want you to bow your head and close your eyes. There might be somebody here who would say, "Pastor, the reason why it's been so hard for me to forgive myself and forgive others is that I've never truly accepted God's forgiveness for my sin. And this morning I realize the need that I have to do that. I want that. I want to be free. And I want to have my guilt and my shame removed." And that's what God's Word tells us. That all that will be over as you give your heart to Christ this morning and receive His forgiveness for your sin. It doesn't matter what that sin is. All of it has been covered by the blood of Jesus Christ when He died for you and for your sin. And that sin, past, present, and future. And so you can be forgiven this morning. But today is also the time and place for maybe somebody in here who is a believer. You've been holding on to that bitterness and you need to let it go. Ask God this morning to help you release that. Ask God to help you make the commitment this morning that you're going to forgive that person, those people, something that may have been totally out of your control. And maybe some of you need to confess, "God, please forgive me for my bitterness toward you, not just toward that other person. God understands your heart, and God loves you. And God's not, he's not a mean, cruel God. And as any parent would say to their child, of course I forgive you. I love you. Now let's move on. Let's experience life together as it should be. And that's what God wants for you this morning. It may mean a phone call. It may mean a letter, an email. It may mean a way of connecting and releasing and making that person realize they may not accept it, but they will know you have forgiven them. Father, I thank you for the power of your forgiveness. The forgiveness that you've shown us for our sin, and the power that you have enabled us to have so that we can forgive others. You have forgiven us. And Lord, help us today to forgive others and to forgive ourselves. Lord, there might be others who need to come join our fellowship this morning, and I pray that they'll come today and unite with us. Be a part of a church that desires to love each other and to help each other in our journey of faith. There might be others who need to come and pray or to have somebody pray for them. Lord, I pray you'll move in their hearts now. In Jesus' name, amen.